Greetings, welcome back to Pyre. Okay, let's continue our journey. It is daybreak. You are to set forth now for the Cairn of Hope, for what appears to be the final time. Thereafter, you shall return here for one last exile's final chance at liberty.
What was that?
You overhear Sir Deluge in a full-on panic as his fellow worm knights attempt to calm him down.
What do you mean? It was the Nightwings. We are not to face them in a coming ride again, are we?
At some point, he realizes Euregon is alive beside his own.
You Nightwings! This knight shall not forgive you. This is transgression. Once we prevail against whichever adversaries we are doomed to face us next, then we shall come for you.
Why must this knight be forced to fly so far above the land and sea?
Bertrude has a hunch that you may find something of value on this route. Wilfred believes this is the faster route. You should have time to pursue your vocations. You spend a quiet afternoon in the barren waste of Shant, surveying the area with some of your companions. My search yields nothing, likewise, Bertrude.
We have discovered naught of any consequence.
Your investigation yields nothing of note. The three of you return to the Wagon for the remainder of the day, where you should have time to pursue your vocations. You and Wolfert will review what observation you have made thus far about the various triumvirates you have confronted on your journey. He has keen insights about some of them. Do we stand between each other's paths to freedom, or we help each other out on our way? I try to always bear this truth in mind.
You know, it seems so awful quiet now, I gotta say. Without that sleepy little character that used to hang around with you, I mean. That looks like this a lot, know what I mean? Hope he found that armor thing he's always going on about. We don't got that in stock just now. Tell all your friends about us because I wasn't in mine.
After making all the necessary preparations amid the desolate spoor of the Cairn of Hope, you and your companions await the commencement of the rites. It is quieter even than usual at the onset of such events. The lone minstrel appears bearing some sort of news. I have checked, and it appears as though the withdrawn have not yet arrived with them, madame. There is no sign of old Milde or anyone. The sigil is not set either. If what he says is true and your adversaries are not present, then you presume the raid cannot commence. However, the stars themselves soon indicate you are mistaken. The riot is set to commence, but your adversaries, they have failed to show.
We take this for an act of acceptance rather than cowardice. It would seem that the rights have nothing left to offer them.
Indeed. As the rites are drawing to a close, some of the triumvirates whom you have met, perhaps they are beginning to decide the stars, are not worth heeding any longer. Old Milde, you wonder whether she would give up on the rites like that. Her obsession with the monstrous Ishlag is such that perhaps she did decide to focus her attention somewhere else. In any case, we have begun the ceremony here, and so I ask that we end it.
We take no pleasure snuffing out a flame disowned.
So he's disappointed to have had to end the ride this way. No one speaks further of the withdrawn back at the Black Wagon. Everyone is instead preoccupied with the ride that is to come. So can scarce believe this is to be the final opportunity to liberate one of your own. I am afraid so. Our plan is an imperfect one, yet here we are, faced with this vital opportunity. He looks over to you. Reader, my girl, please go see for yourself. I think we all know where we are headed next, and I suspect I know whom we shall face when we arrive. The others turn to you as well. You turn toward the wagon's door. You know what you shall see out there. Now, however, the time has come to face it. The dim and fading light of the final star still pierces through the darkness, demanding your attention, guiding you toward the endpoint of your path. You see plain the golden star of Solium. You You are summoned to the fall of Solium for your seventh and final liberation rite. Thus shall the cycle of the rites be ended for an age. You sense that if the rites shall ever commence again, it shall not be during your lifetime, or that any of your companions, even the longest lived ones. The stars reveal to you one thing more. The adversary whom you face shall be Oralek. Already has crossed Scribe's Gate and awaits your arrival. If the eight scribes created the Nightwings in their own likeness, perhaps it is only fitting that the Nightwings should, in the end, be forced to face themselves. Oralek, curse this damnable circle. That it must pit us against him in this our final chance. Let us retire for the night. We shall not have many chances more for rest before our journey is ended. The group disperses as exhaustion sets in. At dawn, you fly to Mount Alodiel to make a final effort to achieve your plan and get somebody home. But who? By dawn, you are already up and about after a troubled slumber. The Black Wagon is prepared for its final voyage to the Fall of Solium. No one speaks. As you lift into the skies, the lone minstrel raises his voice, cutting through the somber mood. Reader, a certain old ballad comes to mind just now. I think it may befit the circumstance. Perhaps it may help to pass the time along our flight. Would you mind it very much if I were to play this song for the Nightwings? You urge the lone minstrel to play his ballad so that all among you might hear it. He begins without another word. Touch down amid the quiet solitude of Mount Alodiel to make pilgrimage to the summit for one last time. There, one last liberation rite shall soon commence. There, one last exile shall regain his or her freedom. All others shall remain to carry out their sentences here in the downside, the reminder of their lives. And in the Commonwealth, the plan of which you are a part shall either come to fruition or all shall be suppressed. After having landed, you join Bertrude on an expedition to the monument of Molten Leaf for what is likely to be the final time.
We beseech ye ancient gods of the last age, and we invoke thine aid. We have traveled far to gain the summit, many times and stood steadfast with our compatriots who seek to leave this place.
We now offer your services eternally, if you would grant us such a boon as to ensure our triumph in the coming night. Long would we serve you, ancient gods, should you accept our offer here and now. So soon she is finished. You return to the wagon in silence, feeling as though molten relief has shown you favor. At dawn, you shall begin your last ascent. For now, your vocation may occupy what little time you have to spare. Parachute gained glory. You notice Bertrude studying the beyond the crystal. She sets it down as you approach.
Furies rebukes our attempt to summon her. She insisted that we are too young to understand.
She must be referring to Sandra. It seems that Bertrude may be able to invoke her.
Then stubborn, that one, possessing of an ancient understanding, olden ways and olden times, and many centuries of history, and knowledge of the eight scribes themselves held captive there, within that green-tinged stone, within that vast on the memories. Would that be we could extract them in some way? Perhaps thou couldst induce the rest of obedience, reading one. For we, she had enough. She claimed obligations on only thee.
She stops and thinks very carefully. The beyond the crystal is not to be tampered with. Your fellow exiles know that its use is at your sole discretion. She backs away from you, still thinking to herself.
Ignores the your inquiries about this reading one. Our reasoning has taken us elsewhere. Her refusal to cooperate is like to be an ancient warning of some sort. It's possible that others of the Southern Box know something of her. But we shall not be tampering further with such sorceries ourselves. That the race refuses to cooperate, so this is her predicament. Is suitably deserved.
She heads out in a huff. But just as the air grows still and quiet, you sense something from the beyond the crystal.
Morphy breath, she says. Can you believe it, reader? Don't be so young and foolish again.
Sandra, dancing, laughs to herself. Your proximity to the beyond the crystal must have been sufficient to invoke her in this case.
That corner of yours is far too curious, I think. But it appears that even she has learned her lesson in this case. Thank the stars, I am beholden to no more than one among you nightwings at a time. And thanks the stars, that happens to be you, other than her. And if that crone attempts to lay her finger on my beyond the crystal again, I shall just have to dorment her dreams till she is my age. Do feel free to mention that if it comes up. Now farewell. You know where to find me, lovely reader.
She vanishes. It seems that Sandra proved resistant to Bertrude's tampering. If so much history is trapped within the beyond the crystal, there it shall remain for the foreseeable future.
You
and Wolfred go over, you know, what you know of the celestial landmarks you have been to, and how their properties impact the Nightwings in the rites.
You can tell he knows many of them well by now.
As we traverse life's many unexpected challenges, so must we cover a variety of terrain along our quests. In the narrow passageways of Mount Alodial, you find a messenger imp looking to bring you the latest news and rumors from the other side.
This time around, the imp brings tidings of Sir Gilman
and what happened to him since his liberation at the fall of Solium, when at last his self-imposed exile came to an end. You learn that his return to the Commonwealth was met with much rejoicing, and that before long, he was promoted to the rank of Waylaid Captain of the Blood Border.
and yet, with tears swelling in his eye, he did refuse the post, stating he no longer had the heart to fight against the hiring remnants as he once did. Idem cast down his helmet, and when next anyone saw him, he was among Wulfred's agents, having joined the revolution to reshape the Commonwealth from within. You thank the messenger imp for the report and salute it crisply as surely Gilmar would have. Soon the news has everyone in the wagon talking.
The tears he shed out have been bottled and thus set aside for use in various salves.
Noble Gilman made the gallant choice, it seems. Our plan comes closer to fruition through his good example and support.
Caesar feels inspired by the news of Gilman's selfless actions. The news of Gilman's liberation fills you and your fellow exiles with newfound resolve. Your companions gain hope for the next fight.
You stand before the scribe's gate with your companions. The gate guardian is there as ever, but you sense something different in her.
The exiles of the Nightwings, we shall not meet again after the coming ride. Tarik and I, it shall be time we take our rest, I think.
Greetings, Celeste. I will tell you that the Nightwings are prepared. Though this time, I am uncertain anyone amongst us will thus.
We have a duty to uphold, Tarik.
And then what, Celeste?
And then nothing. Not for the rites nor us.
Not till the dawn of a new age.
Now, Nightwings, step forward. Please state your names and what it is you seek whilst crossing Scribe's Gate.
One by one, your fellow exiles approach her, now with sureness in their step. If I may, my name is Wulfred Sandalwood. As long as yet to see an age where freedom is one's birthright, and no longer are good people such as this forced to contend for it.
We are Gald Big Patriot. We seek to fulfill the plan of Sandalwood, for we are fond of him and his beliefs, and then to go about our business.
Caesar believes that his ancestors are watching over the Nightwings and seeks to live up to their legacy. But finally, you step forth once more. You, a common wanderer who longs to regain her freedom, and who managed to come this far with this group. The gate guardian observes you for a moment, then motions past the archway toward the summit.
The eight scribes bid the Nightwings welcome. Go forth with glory. Except for you, Tarik. You stay right there. Right for you. I thought you said. The rites are not yet entered, Tarik.
He looks to her, then over to the rest of you. Pardon me, everyone. I shall be there when the stars align. The gate guardian and the lone minstrel remain together as the rest of you depart.
You have gained the summit of Mount Alodiel for the seventh time, the final time in which any one of you shall have a chance to leave the downside.
Hey guys, I guess you probably heard the big news, eh?
Well, I'm going out of business here, I guess. Just hadn't been the same, you know, with what with the stars are fading out and stuff.
Anyway, just wanted to say you guys are great, and I'm sure I'm gonna miss having you guys as customers and all of that. But I got some good news though too. All my stuff, it's all on sale now, and I will throw Auto Expo there just for you, okay? So enjoy, and maybe I'll be seeing you guys around, okay?
Henceforth, all Falcons from school. A 5% off.
See us again, guys.
You have gained the summit of Mount Aurodio for the seventh time. Very few stars remain above to light your way as you await the commencement of the final liberation rite. The lone minstrel finds you clutching the Book of Rites, seeking there perhaps some bit of wisdom that has eluded you thus far. Thus, reader, we may not have a chance to speak again after this, and I have to go. I wish to say that I am grateful for having made your acquaintance, and I shall remember you with fondness. I wish you well, this night and always. Go forth with glory. Then he looks up and he extends his hands in friendship. You clasp it. You see, Wolfred has joined you. All of your companions are there with him, in fact. It is strange for me to say, given the circumstances of our meeting with her, but it has truly been a pleasure. Onward now, let us achieve our plan.
Reading one, thou art both wiser and less irritating than most other men of any kind. We have learned something from thee, and we are grateful.
This wants you to know he has the utmost faith in you. Look upon your fellow exiles, your companions with whom you have withstood the downside, and with whom you shall now conduct this final rite. Begging your pardon, but my time has come. We shall see each other soon. It departs. After this night, the outcome of Wolfert's plan, the plan of which you all have been a part, shall be decided, one way or another. For now, all you can do is to strive to prevail against your final adversaries, so that one last companion may go free. You rise to join your fellow exiles as the last remaining stars ignite. The final liberation rite of this age shall now commence. Papyrus Pond and each of the triumvirates is present and prepared. But before the lone minstrel can concur as per the custom, not another word. The demon Oralek slowly raises his cold fingers to his mask. The false nightwings have arrived at last. Long have I waited this. My freedom once was stolen from me. Then I was cheated of it. Here upon this mountaintop. You may now attempt to take it from me once more.
He stands there for a moment, silent. Then Oral Alec dons his mask and stands prepared. May this damned right cease forever for the misery which they cost.
Nightwings, we shall not meet again after tonight, for the cycle of the rites is all but ended. Thus I would have your decision. On whose behalf shall you conduct this final liberation rite? This one whom you anoint, or else the exile or Alex shall be returned.
That speed, reader. You know what is at stake better than I. I have utmost faith in you to make the best decision, and conduct this rite with glory.
Nightwings,
the star's remaining light grows dim. Your decision, please. It is time now to choose who, if anyone among you, shall go free this one last time. The rest of you shall remain in the downside to the end of your days. One by one, you meet the gazes of each of your fellow exiles. Tizzo, Bertrude, Wolfred, your fellow exiles, your companions, your friends. Together you have come this far, but now the downside and the rise conspire to tear your group apart and disrupt your plan. I prepare to choose this one last time. With but a glance, you reassure your fellow exiles that you know what to do. Trust you with you to do. Tizzo is deeply moved by your decision, but regrets that you are forced to choose just one. Your choice is cast. As for your other companions, you sense a clarity of thought and purpose in each of them. They stand ready to support Tizzo as well as you. Assuredly, my girl. Besides, we stand against Oralek. It is fitting that I should have to confront him myself.
I will his arse, reading wand. Let the remaining stars shed their last light upon our ceremony here.
Those are to be my adversaries then. And who is it, I wonder, who asserts her will over that group? You sense Oralek searching for you, almost reaching out to you.
You, the shadow of the false Nightwings.
They are nothing to me, but you who would relinquish your own liberty for sake of them? Strange. It is fitting then that I should have to face one such as you. Then Oralek stands at the ready, signaling for his two allies to do the same.
By light of dawn, the cycle of the rite shall cease. Let us see if we can finish this ordeal before that time.
The sky above begins to shudder. The final liberation rite is about to commence.
I
am prepared, Celeste.
Then let us song this evening shake the stars themselves.
I, Celeste, let us make sure of it. I am disappointed to see you here, Tizzo, opposing me once more.
Tizzo
is very upset and calls for Oralek to cease speaking to him.
Oralek seems to stare at the imp for a moment.
It is a shame that you are caught up in the middle of all this, little one. Your mind has been poisoned against me.
Tizzo
insists that Oralek is wrong and urges him to stop what he is doing.
I am sorry, Tizzo.
Now, I shall only say this to you once. Stay out of my way. Now, out. Skyrim's ash. Soon shall your pyres all mingle with them. Just then, the skies above begin to rain down fire. The final torus of the cycle of the rites. Just and the ending of the age. Once again, I could not simply stand by and do nothing, Alec. And yet, that is what you did. When last we stood together on this blasted mountain, I fell. You simply stood. Alec, what shall it take for you to be convinced I took no part in your betrayal? Alec seems to consider the question, but only for a moment. Give me my damn freedom. Let me prevail here and now. Would you promise to uphold our plan to bring about a better commonwealth? No, I make no promises. I owe you nothing. Then I am sorry, Oralek. My love of country comes before all else. More than your freedom and our friendship is at stake. You love be damned, Wulfred. Let us stand as adversaries then. So the first Nightwing's birthday fangs at last. But that cannot be your finest effort. You think you deserve your freedom more than I? Then fight for it, damn you! All of you, you shall rot here, you shall rot as I have. All these many years, you false Nightwings, who deny me once again my rightful liberty? You who deny that liberty to all of the triumvirate you face and vanquish under the guise of the traditions of those blasted scribes. Come, let us continue this glorious affair. like stands, breathing heavily. He looks back on the thin lake of flame that his smoldering pyre, before turning his attention back to a triumvirate. So he's lavishing a great deal of generous praise on you after having prevailed. You look upon Tizo for what you expect shall be the last time you see each other. Any moment now, the Shimmer Pool shall engulf him. Any moment now, he shall return to glory and join the Wolfred's agents in the Commonwealth to help achieve the plan. Any moment now, the cycle of the rites shall end until at least the dawn of new age. Any moment now, Tizo seems very concerned. All of a sudden, something is wrong. Each prior time upon the fall of Solium, the Shimmer Pool has opened, following the liberation rite, and taken in whichever exile prevailed. But now, all is still, and the light of the stars above has all but died. You sense a growing fear that it is already too late. The Shimmer Pool shall not reveal itself again. Ralek approaches, his head bowed. The eight scribes saved their greatest treachery for last. Then something else catches his notice.
Wait.
A sudden rush of starlight cascades through the stillness of the summit. The Shimmer Pool has appeared again, different somehow, but open. Tizo looks upon it, but it does not engulf him, or at least not yet.
It seems I was mistaken then. In the eight scribes, this is not their greatest treachery. It is their greatest jest. The Shimmer Pool is flung wide open. It seems that all are worthy now of freedom.
It seems Oralek strides toward the Shimmer Pool, but halt, Oralek. Oralek glances over at the long minstrel, almost in surprise. The Shimmer Pool has lost most of its strength. You step inside, and you shall surely drown. Of that, I can assure you. He laughs to himself at this.
Then we have all been cheated.
No. The Shimmer Pool is revealed, and even one of you may still return, as planned. But as for who returns, someone shall have to choose. Ere the last light of the stars is extinguished, and the rites cease to be, this is the final trial of the scribes.
The final trial of the scribes. Then our confrontation, the liberation rite, it was all meaningless?
No. The victor of the confrontation is to be the one who to make the choice among those close to the scribes, either the anointed or she who anointed them. These are things that this means either he can go to the Commonwealth or you can.
It shall be either you, the reader, or it shall be either or.
Tizo, please make your decision quickly, lest it shall be forfeit. I do not know for how much longer the light of the stars shall offer you this gift. It seems then that Tizo has made up his mind.
This just as you.
He wants you to be free. You are free to go. This all wishes to give up his freedom so that you may regain yours.
Very well.
With madame, the choice which Tiso made, or rather, or the choice which he gave, it is now yours to make instead. This choice. It may keep bouncing back and forth like this? Absurd. It may, until such time as one of you is willing to accept the burden and the outcome of the choice. This is the trial, and I fear that there is little time remaining now. Reader, if you and your companion are too cordial with each other to accept that freedom, either one of you, then I shall gladly take it. Freedom ought to be more than some flirtatious trifle to exchange. Reader, what is your will?
Thank you, Tiso. Thank you.
Your mind is made up. You have chosen to be free yourself. I see and understand. Then it is done. Tiso looks to you this one last time. His head filled with unspoken understanding. You turn then to the lone minstrel for an instant, but another instant later. He's gone. He and everyone. All you feel is the coldness of the rush of water coursing all around you. Tiso gave his freedom so that you may yet have yours. You feel that Tiso was have yours. Exiled reader returned to the Commonwealth. She was to be the last. The stars had faded, and the cycle of the rise had run its course. She found the Commonwealth in great upheaval, spurred by the efforts of 6 liberated exiles. Wilfred Sandalwood's revolutionary plan had incited the masses. These exiles and the starless sky portend the return of the scribes. The people surge into the streets, shoulder to shoulder. Led by the 6 exiles, their voices shook the heavens. The leadership of the Commonwealth panicked. No blood was shed that night, and by dawn it was over. The leaders of the Commonwealth had cast themselves back into exile or joined in this new cause. That was thus, in its 838th year, the Commonwealth had fallen. The new Sachian Union declared its sovereignty in the next year. Among the changes its elected leaders ushered in, they vowed never to cast their people into exile. And they abolished the old Commonwealth decree forbidding literacy. Today we still remember all of this, and we remember the exiles of the downside whose deeds led to the dawning of our age, whether they return or not. As the cycle of the rise drew to a close, it grew evident that the chance at freedom from downside had forever slipped from Dalbert and Almer's old heart's grasp. Thus, they and the exiles of the Faith returned to Jomwer Valley, for there they struggled to get by, as exiles of the downside tend to do. Sometime after the riots had ended, the old hearts at last heard the news that the Commonwealth had fallen. This was well after the fact, of course, but it brought old Talbot great joy. Despite his forthright manner, he had no love for the nation that cast him down along with his son. Talbot Oldheart passed peacefully in his sleep before the next new moon. In his final days, he implored his son to undertake a pilgrimage to the scribes. Almer never shared his father's view of the scribes, but respected Talbot's wishes. And so, after a period of mourning, Albert began a new journey. Not a day went by that Almer Oldheart did not think about his father, and give thanks to him, and speak to him at morning and at night. What that the stars had shown, for surely Dalbert's would be there among them, smiling down at his son and watching over him and his kin. After the final liberation rite, Lendl refused to believe that the rites had truly ended. He would sit through night after consecutive night, staring into the blackness of the sky, awaiting any kind of sign that he may gain another chance at freedom. No such sign ever came. His fellow accusers started to express concern for him. Survival had become their top priority once liberty had slipped from their grasp. But Lendl dismissed them as weak fools. He insisted rather forcefully that any evening now the stars would shine for him again and mark the way toward his inevitable freedom. He was, of course, mistaken. The others in his triumvirate were left with little choice but to abandon him. After that, the exile known as Lendl the Liar was never seen again. However, there have since been sightings of a bedraggled demon who wanders the downside and bears Lendl's cruel countenance, suggesting he yet lives. All his life, Sir Delouche had fled from one danger only to find himself facing another. He had escaped the war-torn waters of the Sea Dominion, he had escaped the blood border of the Commonwealth, and now he had escaped the rites. After the rites had ended, many exiles wrapped up in the ancient test were crestfallen as their last chances to return to their homes vanished, along with the stars above. But Delouche did not mind. For this outcome meant that, at last, there was no burden of responsibility weighing down on him. While most of his fellow exiles of the Pyre Hearts yet longed for the waters of the Sea Dominion, driven as ever by their impulses toward conflict, Delouche settled down. With him remained one of his companions, whom Lady Seagrass, who had taken a liking to him for some reason. Reportedly, they disappeared into the waters of Wormgulf, which may begin to explain the significant increase in worm population observed in the vicinity. After the cycle of the rites had ceased, Witch Ulmilde returned to the Flogging Hands region, where she sealed herself within the pit of Mirith. There, even her fellow exiles of the Withdrawn allegedly grew unnerved after a time and left her to her vile work. Some time later, the pit of Mirith erupted into flame. So intense was the conflagration that it could be seen all the way from Jamura Valley. Arson was suspected, though the cause was never verified, and many bog dwellers in the region were forced to flee. A tempest blowing from the north finally quenched the flames. When at last the ashes settled and the grounds had cooled, the site of the fire was scarred beyond recognition. No trace of Witch Ulmilde could be found. As for the contents of the pit of Mirith, which notably included a profane object though thought to be the remains of Ishlak, all of it was gone as well. Back in the Sahian Union, Ulmilde's repeated threats of the return of Ishlak were thoroughly investigated, and no credence was found to any of her claims. But Barker Ashpaws never had much interest in returning to the Commonwealth, for he always found its bylaws to be stifling. So when the rites ended, he did not care at first. He soon grew very bored. The rites had given his life a certain sense of structure he had always needed, given the raw anticipation of it all. like he decided to continue conducting the rites for the thrill of it. He bent some of the rules and replaced some of the objects, but it was close enough. His pack mates, the Zidanes, proved more than happy to participate, and thus they ran against each other back in Jamura Valley. Gradually, other exiles familiar with the rites, as well as those who had not heard of it at all, started to take an interest. They ended up giving Barker Ashbows some healthy competition. His old friend with Rookie Greentail ceased meaning anything to him, and he forgot all about it amid his new pursuits. Ultimately, even Barker Ashbows, who had led such a directionless existence to that point, found something of a calling for the rites. Whether he took the rites less seriously than any other exile of his time or more was oft debated by those who watched him work. Throughout her exile, Tamitha Tain was motivated by a single goal to return to the Commonwealth and exact vengeance on her ancient enemies. When she realized the rites had ended and that she would never see her mountain home again, she nonetheless remained determined to aid her people however possible. She had granted certain information pertaining to the intentions of the Nightwings and had formed a pact to regroup on the other side after the liberation. Other such reports exposed certain weaknesses in the Commonwealth defenses and revealed to the Highwing remnants the opportunity for a risky but potentially impactful strike. As Tamitha could not participate in the assault, she learned what happened well after the outcome. On that night known as the Scribe's Return, the Commonwealth had fallen. The Highwing remnants thus prevailed at last without even having to fight. Soon after the fall of the Commonwealth, Tamitha learned her blood sister Pamitha was an accessory to the successful outcome. Tamitha was very skeptical of this, but as similar reports kept mounting, she soon accepted the prevailing option, however grudgingly. Once a messenger imp arrived bearing some sort of message, seemingly from Tamitha. However, Tamitha turned it away. She would not give in to an impulse to forgive. Knowing that the conflict on the other side has ended, Tamitha retreated to the cracks of Black Basin and grew even more distant. Those closest to her surmised that her inability to reconcile with her blood sister was at the heart of this. Though for her part, Tamitha never once admitted to any such weaknesses. When Manly Tinderstauf realized the rites had ended and that he no longer could return to the Commonwealth through this ancient means, he was outraged. He cursed the scribe, spewing forth such a slew of blasphemy as to be very unbecoming of one of his high status and bearing. When at last he claimed himself, he focused all his energies on attempting to find another means of homecoming. He maintained regular contact with his wealthy family on the other side via messenger imp, and used their vast resources to explore other means of escape. He tried using an elaborate pulley system. He attempted to retrofit a flying back wagon with superior propulsion. He tried an imp raft, a hot air balloon, even prayer. Nothing worked. There was only one way to escape the downside, and now it was gone. Tinderstauf bankrupted his family in these vain attempts. At last, such was his shame that he retreated to the teeming woods of Black Basin, to Cinderroot. There he yet was, complaining to his comrades of the chastity who still put up with him, either about his own misfortune or the latest news from the other side. Once it became clear to Ignarius that the rites were drawing to a close, he knew that it was time for him and the Tempers to call it quits. But first, he and the Tempers decided to celebrate, and that they did for many, many nights. The rivalry didn't eventually subside, the exiles parted amicably and went their separate ways. He roamed the downside then, searching for some meaning in his life, sometimes taking odd jobs requiring his brute strength. He never remained alone for very long and took on many lovers in his time. However, he sometimes thought about the one he had called Crowley Hans and what became of her. Though his glory days as the most powerful conductor of the rites had long since passed, he always enjoyed the fearsome reputation he had cultivated at that time. After the shimmer pool closed for what would be the last time, Oralek looked around him in the flickering light of the Nightwing's still burning pyre. He then turned to the pole of Solium and looked up toward the black, starless sky. He cursed the eight scribes, then one after another. After that, he strode forward towards the water coursing from the side of Mount Alodiel, and without hesitating, he cast himself down. Oralek's body was never recovered. The drop from Mount Alodiel does not appear survivable, though Oralek did survive it once. That time, however, he was filled with fury. Such was the betrayal he had suffered when his fellow exiles claimed his rightful freedom. This time, Oralek filled with nothingness and chose to leave the Mount Sign in the one way he still knew he could. The other Nightwings who were witness to this never forgot what they saw. After the cycle of the rites ceased turning, the lone minstrel bade the remaining Nightwings take the black wagon and seek their fortunes elsewhere in the downside. Their parting was heartfelt but brief. Hugh remained there at the summit of Mount Alodiel with Celeste, where the two of them would chronicle the final outcome of the cycle. Neither Taric nor Celeste were ever seen again. We know all this now through song attributed to them. Some claim these songs originated in taverns of the Sahrian Union and merely were imbued with weight of folklore. However, exiles liberated from the downside corroborated each other's claims at having met the duo that presided over the liberation rites. Another folk tale suggests that these minstrels were heralds of the scribes. Having fulfilled their obligations, they departed the world we know and rejoined their patrons. One of their famous songs describes another simple outcome, that the two gave up their duties to the rise in favor of a life that they could share together. In any case, they are likely to remain the subject of such verses and such songs, for it was they who watched over the rites and ushered in our times. When the cycle of the rites ceased turning, Wolf at Sandalwood turned toward the starless sky and closed his eyes and prayed. It was all that he could do at the stage of his plan. He aspired to assemble with liberated exiles representing each of the eight largest ethnic groups composing the population of the Commonwealth. They would stand together as a vision of the eight scribes returned, inspiring the masses to embrace an older set of values from before the Commonwealth had tightened its grip. With the rites ending sooner than expected, this ideal scenario became impossible. Sandalwood's own freedom, for instance, was now forfeit. Yet the plan did have contingencies. Fortunately, most of those contingencies did not prove necessary. Word reached him that, on the night of Scribe's return, his fellow liberated Nightwings stood together, and their voices echoed through the streets. These former exiles, who all had disappeared into the ranks of the Commonwealth's own leadership, now stood united with its people, who pulled from their homes in solidarity. It was imperative to Sandalwood that this stand against the Commonwealth be peaceful in its nature. An overwhelming show of popular support would be more than enough. Ensuring this was his priority, and in the end, the result was self-evident. The plan's goal had been achieved. Sandalwood kept busy after that as much as possible, providing counsel from afar to those who would be at the forefront of the birth of the Sarian Union. Of course, being stranded in the downside meant that there was only so much he could do. Of course, resting assured that the future of the nation was in capable hands, he turned his attention to the remaining exiles of the downside. They might never return to that new nation, but at least they could experience its triumphs and its struggles in some vicarious way. So he took to his old work, writing and printing. As literacy began to spread again throughout the Sarian Union, so too did exiles of the downside tend to it. For his part, Sandalwood helped to teach as many as he could. More than that, he provided the material to read, a semi-annual report about the latest events both in the Sarian Union and the Downside. This political gave many exiles something to look forward to. One of his allies in all this was the imp, Tizo, with whom he traveled all across the Downside. Sandalwood often cited Tizo as the wellspring of his own enthusiasm for a brighter future. Such was the creature's spirit. He enjoyed exchanging letters with the reader of the Nightwings, who kept him well abreast of how their other comrades and the fledging nation fared. As Wulfred Sandalwood gained more fame throughout this land for all his sacrifices and his contributions, it is said that he remained steadfast about two things. The first was that the cause itself ought to remain in focus. The freedom that the people had achieved, it was a gift to be cherished, a set of values that needed to be nurtured. The second point he made was that he himself had little to do with the outcome. He would often praise the exiles of the Nightwings who had stood with him, each in turn by name. He never forgot any of them. One day, to commemorate his birthday, the people of the Sarian Union unveiled a monument depicting him and the Nightwings as imagined in their prime. While Sandalwood did not learn of it until much later, it is said that he was moved to tears then by the gesture. It has since ensured that those of us with memories more valuable than that of Sandalwood likewise remember the achievements of his fellow former exiles and our cause. With the rights drawn to a close, the slag market's revenues fell precipitously, and Falcon Run was forced to liquidate his assets and close up shop. Yet, as it's sometimes the case with those of an entrepreneurial leaning, this time of hardship led to an epiphany, or at least a sudden change of fortune. One day, Falcon Run had a run-in with a messenger imp bearing news from the other side. Ron gave to it one of his remaining trinkets, which could not be sold. The following week, the messenger imp returned to him bearing a tidy sum of wealth in newly minted coinage from the Sarian Union. Falcon Ron cut a long-term deal with the messenger imp then and there. Though his trade remained a grey area from a legal standpoint in the Sarian Union, the newfound fame of the Downside caused Falcon Run's good to explode in popularity. He later signed an elaborate agreement with Big Bertrude and found a distribution partner on the other side through Rookie Greentail, whose own business had expanded. Especially in the Sarian Union, Falcon Run's goods are still known for their superior quality, though he assumes no liability for any side effects. Several exiles of the Nightwings cared more for the plan of Sandalwood than to return home from the Downside. The crone called Big Bertrude was a prime example. She had found a suitable environment to live within the dismal region known as Flagging Hands. There, she had built up a thriving place of business known to many exiles in the land. With the rites having ended, she returned to her preoccupations, walking away almost as though nothing had happened. When one gets to be more than 400 years of age, perhaps then even more monumental events such as the culmination of the rites or the collapse of the Commonwealth are seen as triumphant matters. Much of her effort was doubtless due to the influence of Sandalwood, some whom she had admired now for decades. She had made clear that he could not require her feelings for him, but what could have been a heartful dismissal led only to a deeper understanding between them. By and large, Bertrude kept focusing on her work, whether casting small enchantments or imbuing talismans. The work brought her a sense of purpose, she would say. In the Commonwealth, such services were strictly forbidden. But in the Downside, there was a real need for simple luxuries, which the competing slag market could not always provide. Thus did Big Bertrude continue to live up to her name, and the tales of her days with the Nightwings made her that much more of a living legend. between. After regaining her freedom, Pami Fatain found herself in a difficult position. Having once betrayed her people of the Hiring Remnants, she knew that she would not be welcome in her native home. She did not trust the Commonwealth either. Instead, she found her place among Wulfred Sandalwood's agents, who were busy doing their part to fulfill the plan. As it turned out, the plan was a success. Pami Fatain stood shoulder to shoulder with her other fellow former exiles, and truly, they were a sight to behold. A disturbing rumor later spread that night, the Hiring Remnants were slated to mount an assault, which, for some reason, never came to pass. Pamifa denied any knowledge of involvement. Afterward, Pamifa played an active part in negotiating terms between the Hiring Remnants and the new nation that would become our Saurian Union. Her previous attempts at something of the sort led to her exile. She must have felt some satisfaction to succeed this time around. Sometime later, Pamifa had an unexpected run-in with Rookie Greentail, with whom she had spent a fair amount of time while traveling with the Nightwings. Under this new set of circumstances, it turned out the two had more to talk about and rather more in common. They would often put to test which one was able to outdrink the other. It is unclear as to which one of them prevailed in that contest in the end. One day, Pamifa received an invitation to return to the Hiring Remnants, where she was to be fully pardoned. She held out a hope that she might see her blood sister Tamifa there, knowing full well that Tamifa did not regain her freedom. Tamifa did later learn that Pamifa was welcomed back by her people, however, she never responded to her blood sister's attempts to contact her. Pamifa in turn did not expect forgiveness from her at any point. Nonetheless, she kept on trying to reach out, she said, to ruffle up her feathers just a bit. Later, when asked, Pami Fatain admitted she felt though she had no home to call her own. This was during an interview conducted amid the extensive trip abroad, where she had traveled thousands of leagues beyond the bounds of the Saurian Union. Pamifa continued to journey, thus citing it reminded her of when she was younger and could fly unfettered. After her liberation, Jodarius soon became an icon of the movement that led to the collapse of the Commonwealth and the rise of the Saurian Union. Her horns and stern countenance inspired the people to believe that she was Soldia Moor, reborn. She became a great, if reluctant, leader. In the uncertain times that followed, Jodarius' seasoned expertise often came into play, both in matters of security and of state. For instance, she conscripted and trained a team of volunteers in public safety. The community did not know what to make of such a cordial bunch at first, but soon came to value their service. They have stood for the people ever since, and we celebrate their founding day each year. She remained close with Hedwin all through this experience, and they supported each other through their struggles many, many times. She kept an eye on Fae, who nonetheless demonstrated a surprising knack to get by on her own, though Jodarius was always willing to provide assistance, just in case. She continued training on her own, a regiment that grew stricter with each passing year. There were those who sought to train with her, and she sometimes obliged. There remained one other constant in her life. She would always remember her days among the Nightwings, and with fondness for the most part. The Commonwealth had never provided a sense of home for the one they had called Fae the Fair, so she was surprised on her return that she was so well treated. She felt uneasy about it, and besides, she knew that she would do her best to fulfill the pledge she had made to her friends. Even she could not have expected the impact she would have on the events that followed, which gave rise to a Saurian Union. Despite not fitting the image of any of the eight scribes, Fae nonetheless stood out alongside the others amid the teeming masses of the night of the scribes' return. She spoke of the scribes with such conviction and sincerity that the crowd was very moved. After the fall of the Commonwealth, there was a renewed interest in the legend of the eight scribes and many new interpretations of the histories and teachings. Fair found herself at the center of all this. Her way of speaking continued to compel a growing audience. She swayed many people from their astralist beliefs. Soon, the Eighth World, which had lost favor with the people during the reign of the Commonwealth, sought her out and asked her formally to join, and she did right away. Through it all, she would wonder how her little friend Tiso had fared. While they were divided now by a great distance, he always remained in her heart. She cited her relationship with Jodario as the single most important in her life. Jodario would always provide for her a circumspect perspective and the wisdom of experience. Whenever she felt genuine doubt, which was not very often, she sought out the reader of the Nightwings. If there was anyone whom she trusted as much as the scribes, it was her. Fe always was devoted to her faith, but more so to her friends. Many people in the Sarian Union cited that her gentle manner and unwavering conviction helped them brave the changing times with courage and with grace. After Rookie Grintel earned back his freedom, he returned to a lavish welcome ceremony in the Commonwealth, as was the tendency for liberated exiles. It was everything he could have hoped for, and soon enough he was well off, surrounded by luxury and choosing between various exciting opportunities. However, he must have given in to his better judgment, as he did end up sliding with Wulfred Sandalwood's revolutionary forces as he promised. On the night of Scribe's return, Grintel was there with the others, inspiring the masses. He never looked prouder, the very image of Jamuel Manymane himself. When dawn finally came and it became clear that the Commonwealth that everybody knew would be no more, he realized many new opportunities awaited. He began quite a lucrative career for himself, manufacturing and selling replica merchandise inspired by the downside. His main struggle was to meet demand. An aspect of his conscience cautioned him against making light of such a thing, but the money was too good, and soon his family was as well off as he always said. One of his orders of business was to seek out one of his old companions, Pamifatane, to whom he took a liking during their quest for freedom. They bonded further over love and of drink, and supported one another through uncertain times that lay in store. He also kept in close touch with Gilman, ever the perfect practice partner. They would train together often, taking care to stay in tip-top shape as much as possible throughout the years. Grintel always did his best to keep in touch with all his many friends, and knew that he owed his fortunes to them. He made a special point of staying close with the group of friends he came to know so well during his time in the Nightwings, wherever they were. They shared a special understanding that put even Grintel at a loss for words sometimes. When Gilman returned to the Commonwealth, he believed that he had regained something even more important than his freedom, his honor. Gilman relinquished his knighthood and declined an opportunity to serve as captain on the Blood Border. He was not interested in fighting any longer. Yet, as is sometimes the case with those such as he, a circumstance soon came about in which there came a need for him to once again make use of his military training. Thankfully, however, the scribe's return ended peaceably. Gilman was on edge throughout that night, expecting violence to erupt at any moment, but the moment never came. When the matter was at last put to rest, then Gilman truly knew his time as a knight had ended. He declared to all those in earshot that he would never fight again, unless, of course, there arose some other extraordinary set of circumstances, again requiring him to fight, but he certainly hoped not. He still trained regularly, just in case, especially with his fleet-footed friend, Rookie Grintel. He was always grateful for the counsel of the reader, and would regale her over and over about the time they squashed the spawn of unfathomed plans. By that point, He had long forgotten about his days under the leadership of Sir Deluge, his former commander. Breaking free of his abusive leadership was his first step toward gaining a bit of self-respect. Gilman never did return to his homeland of the Sea Dominion, and was content to lead a monastic life on a small residence in the hills. It was just high up enough to make him keep striving to conquer his fear of heights. Other than that, an intense daily training regimen and the occasional visit from an old companion was more than enough to keep him optimistic and engaged. He knew by then that honor was not something to be won, but a contract with oneself to be renewed each day. After his liberation, Hedwyn was instrumental in the events leading to the fall of the Commonwealth and was vital to the outcome of the plan. The peaceful outcome of the Scribe's return was attributed to several key factors. One of them was the underlying ambition of the plan itself. Another was Hedwyn's visibility among the people in the streets. Identified to be a liberated exile, he was believed to be Goliathnian reborn. More importantly, however, was that one of the winged harps of the Hiring Remnants accompanied him. She was later identified as Vikani Shan. Their bond was symbolic of what was at stake that night and proved vital to the peace that followed. In all his days as a leader in the Sarian Union, Hedwyn oft confided in his friend Trudario. Despite her intense manner, there was no one whom he trusted more in times where circumspection was required. Hedwyn would often think back about the vow he made at the beginning of his quest for freedom. Although he cherished all the friendships he made, that pledged to Judario, Rookie Greentail, and the reader of the Nightwings that they might all be free again together. His promise had come to pass, though he always knew that this was not his own doing. He was always deeply grateful to the other three, his closest friends. While the others who stood with the Nightwings were not all able to remain in contact thus, Hedwyn thought of each of them often, and so in turn did they oft think of him. After the cycle of the rites ceased turning, records of what happened to the Black Wagon of the Nightwings become inconclusive and contradictory. Some accounts suggest that the exiles of the Nightwings who remained in the downside continued to make use of the Black Wagon as a place of shelter and a means of travel. However, there is no record of what happened to the wagon's contents, such as the Book of Rites or the Beyonder Crystal, said to be haunted by the apparition of Sandra the Unseen. One possibility is that when the lone minstrel took his leave, he took the Beyonder Crystal with him, for he was thus obliged. By this line of reasoning, however, the Black Wagon itself should have been taken also. Others remain skeptical that the Beyonder Crystal ever existed, or rather, that the visions that it granted were anything other than the result of an active imagination or a fever dream. The Bog Dwellers of the Southern Bogs offer still another explanation, though they are familiar with binding enchantments. If there existed such an object in which the Sisters of the Arch had been expelled for more than 800 years, then the enchantment could have expired long along with the light of the stars. What this would have meant for Sandra and the Beyonders is difficult to say for certain, other than it might have meant that they were finally released. Nevertheless, the fate of Sandra and the Beyonder Crystal remains unknown. Yet, those exiles of the Nightwings who claimed to have seen this apparition all spoke of her with degrees of reverence or, perhaps, a little fear. Once the rites had ended, the Imp Teasel had a job to do. Quite unlike most exiles trapped forever in the downside, and the lone minstrel asked that he watch over the Black Wagon, which the Nightwings had used extensively for travel and for shelter all throughout their quest. Teasel obliged, for he knew that wagon as well as its drive imps inhabitants perhaps better than anyone. What became of the wagon exactly was never verified, as evidence of Teasel throughout work. After that, he liked to while away his days with any of his friends or else with fellow imps. His friend Thunderwood sometimes called for his assistance, and Teaser was always happy to oblige. The two would often reminisce about their times with the Lone Minstrel. Teaser often missed his interaction with the leader of the Nightwings. They had quickly built quite a rapport back in the downside. Indeed, Teaser would often express wistful gratitude for all his time with the Nightwings and their many adventures throughout the land that was always his home. Other than that, Teaser would sometimes help interpret the messenger imps' rallying news to and from the Saurian Union. Despite having gained significant celebrity abroad, he never let it go to his head. And he would go fishing in the Sea of Swords at every single chance he got. There's one more account which warrants mention. Then the Nightwings conducted the rites under the guidance of a leader. Little is known of her. However, some accounts of her begin to paint a picture. We know she was of common birth, always directionless and prone to misremembering at times. The journey to the Downside left her close to death. It was then that the Nightwings found her. They brought her from the brink. She showed them the path. She pressed onward with the others. Long they wandered, longing always to regain her freedom. Thus did the cycle of the rites commence its final turns. When the final rite arrived, the reader's freedom was at stake. That freedom she, indeed, achieved ere the morning's light. From that point on, accounts of her diverge. It is said the voice which troubled her she never heard again. Some say she chose to tend the Saurian Union's land, though whether that is true only she knows. Someday perhaps that reader's own star shall emerge. Then it shall pierce the dark of night in all its brilliant glory. And then until such time and ever after, all of us give thanks.